Samsung Foundry is just one of the many arms of the sprawling Samsung Group chaebol, but has pushed itself into top echelon of the standalone foundry industry. In recent months, they have been aggressively taking on client business from the market leader TSMC. In the last 3 months, Samsung has won business from the following fabless semiconductor companies: Qualcomm, middle-class mobile chip 750 with their 8-nanometer process, and the higher-end 875 with their 5-nanometer process, NVIDIA with the highly desired RTX 380-390 graphics card using their 8-nanometer process, IBM with the Power 10 using their 7-nanometer process, and Google and Cisco, products unreported. All these companies have worked with TSMC before, and some were even core TSMC customers. Market analysts estimated that in the second quarter of 2020, Samsung Foundry had leapfrogged competitors like UMC and Global Foundries into second place behind TSMC. Its market share was just 3.7% in 2016. Now it is at 19.1%. The next quarter, though, in 3Q 2020, TSMC beat back its competition. It took share from Samsung and the whole industry to settle at a 54% share of the industry, according to industry research firm TrendForce. This movement is likely due to big purchases in the market by Huawei and Apple. The race between the semiconductor foundry industry leaders is heating up, and in this video, I want to compare the two guys at the front. In 2005, Samsung Electronics alone foundry industry. Their first major customer was Qualcomm. They had already achieved a strong position in the memory chip market, DRAM. However, the DRAM world is a highly cyclical one. Revenues can go up or down by something like 35% from year to year. At that time, Samsung had already built the foundry capacity to make the chips for its growing smartphone and devices businesses, to create a brand new business line servicing other companies using what had once been just an internal division, made good business sense. Samsung Electronics, its parent company, does not break out the foundry's revenues and earnings individually. Instead, it's rolled up with the memory chips business. This means that the foundry is somewhat shielded from the pressures of making money. TSMC, on the other hand, is publicly traded and its stock scrutinized by shareholders, sometimes monthly. This allows Samsung Foundry to undercut TSMC on pricing per wafer for advanced nodes. For a lot of fabless companies, that matters. Every dollar saved is a dollar profits earned. Samsung Foundry pushes hard on adopting the latest and greatest technologies. It is part of their sales pitch as one of the last leading edge foundries in the market. As Executive VP and Head E.S. Jung said in 2017, "You need a technology that can wow your clients. Without such advanced technology, it will be difficult to win back customers from your rivals." And they've really backed their words. They're one of the few foundries in the world to have a good number of EUV machines built by ASML, second probably only to TSMC. Samsung supports these foundry ambitions with mountains of cash. The total group spent $18 billion in 2019 in total capital expenditures for semiconductors and is estimated to spend another $23 billion in 2020. Note, though, that most of this spend is going towards the memory business. We don't actually know how much is going to the foundry, dedicated foundry business. Finally, Samsung Foundry's position as the last leading-edge foundry is more critical than people might think. If a fabless semiconductor maker wants to make chips with a leading-edge process, they either go to TSMC or Samsung. That's it. Global Foundry stopped all 7-nanometer development in 2018. UMC focuses on specialty processes. SMIC has their own issues to deal with. So the market's pretty small. And not being TSMC gives Samsung a place in the foundry market. It keeps the Taiwanese giant from having a complete stranglehold on the industry and prevents them from getting complacent. TSMC is a dedicated foundry. They literally invented the industry. They do not compete with their customers, and that is a core marketing tactic of theirs. Being the first mover in the industry has allowed them the chance to grab a majority of market share. They have had consistently over 50% market share for the entire dedicated foundry industry for a long time. Their ecosystem is a core strength of theirs. and manufacture over 10,000 different products using 260 distinct technologies for over 500 customers. The feedback loops from those close customer relationships help increase their technical and business competitive advantages. What also helps increase those competitive advantages is that they spend a megaton of money on their capital expenditure. Samsung capital expenditures are quite large, but TSMC's are as big, or in many cases, bigger. The company regularly spends over $15 billion a year on its foundries. TSMC alone makes over 50% of Taiwan's entire R&D spend. TSMC's sales per wafer is higher than that of Samsung's. Market research firm The Information Network quotes that TSMC's total sales per wafer is about $3,338, Samsung's is about $2,490. That's an average total across all technologies. This higher number is due to the product mix. Wafers made with cutting-edge tech cost a lot more. Market estimates of TSMC's wafer prices for 5-nanometer nodes peg it at something like $17,000 per 300-millimeter wafer. Some 36% of TSMC's revenues come from nodes 7 nanometers or smaller. Samsung, in contrast, makes about 20% of their sales from such nodes per market estimates. We don't know what those gross margins are for those most advanced wafers, but they are presumably more profitable than wafers made with less advanced processes due to the fact that there's more foundry alternatives available. Basically, what I'm saying is that TSMC is more profitable because they're selling a lot more high-end wafers. Lastly, TSMC's style is much more conservative than Samsung's. TSMC takes things step by step. This is partly because they need to be able to deliver for their customers without fail, especially Apple. For more information on that, you can check out my video about how Apple changed TSMC. As a result of their conservatism, they fall behind in adopting cutting-edge technologies. For example, in their 7-nanometer process generation, Samsung was first to adopt the new EUV lithography. Meanwhile, TSMC's first-generation 7-nanometer process stuck with an older process called DUV. EUV only came out later in that process node. But because they are more conservative, the quality of their products tend to be better and are more apt to scale it. One way this is illustrated is to look at transistors per square millimeter. Such a metric is not the end-all be-all in comparing performances between competing nodes. There are other factors, for example, like yield, but it is a good start. With those caveats in mind, Samsung's 5-nanometer generation EUV-based process has about 126 million transistors per square millimeter. TSMC's comparable N5 EUV-based process, the one making Apple A14 chip right now, has around 173 million. Like I said, not the end-all be-all, but a good rule of thumb. So will Samsung catch up? Is TSMC failing? If you're personally asking me, I feel like Samsung is going to capture a lot more of the market in the future, if only because they can keep taking share from the rest of the competition. The Samsung Group has a good market track record. I can only recall them really failing in automobiles. And they got money from their memory chips business. They got a captive customer in their handsets business, and they're determined to make an impact on the market. But there are forces keeping TSMC in first place for the foreseeable future. Nodes on the leading edge are only going to get more expensive, not only for the foundries, but also for the fabless semiconductor companies themselves. It's said that the cost of developing a single 3-nanometer node chip would cost something like $1.5 billion all in. And these technologies and nodes are not exactly one-to-one interchangeable. These costs increasingly shrink the market of customers who can possibly afford this stuff. It also raises the costs of switching for the companies who might want to switch foundries. So you end up with a solidified circle of luxury customers and luxury providers at the leading edge, jockeying with each other from year to year. The big wild card that can flip the table, of course, is Apple. NVIDIA and Qualcomm are important customers, but Apple is probably the biggest and single most important foundry customer in the world. Probably even more so after Huawei got booted. Their checks fund a wave of R&D development that other companies can ride. TSMC allowed its entire 5-nanometer output to go to a single client, and that's how big of a deal Apple is to them. As long as Apple stays with TSMC, I think TSMC stays number one and keeps 50% market share. So no, I don't think TSMC is going to fail. Yes, I think they are in a tough competitive market, but that pushes them like nothing else can. And I think that's a good thing. All right, everyone, have a good day. Bye-bye.